papers were formed our quorum. May I call the meeting to order on the 24th of November. Since the last meeting in November, we've issued new papers. And for the discussion items for our next meeting, dated 22nd of April, please refer to our list of outstanding items. And we've also sent you our list of follow-up actions. For the next meeting scheduled for the 22nd of April, we have a long list of agenda items to cover. MTR, bylaws, and Mass Transit Railway, Northwest Railway bylaw, restrictions on the size of personal objects that can be carried into the MTR network, and progress update on enhancement of the MTR station facilities. And we've also got a letter from Ms. Hon LEUNG Che-cheung on a particular item, and we'll cover that in April. Now, because the 22nd of April will be a long meeting, and we will discuss whether a special meeting should be convened. If there are no further issues, please invite the administration to join us. Present for this meeting, we have representatives from the THB and the Highways Department. Mr. Yao Xingmo, Undersecretary. Mr. Peter Lau, Director of Highways. And from MTR, we have a team led by Dr. Fulke Wong. The first thing to cover is progress updates of the construction of the West Island Line, South Island Line East, and Kwun Tong Line extension. Undersecretary, please. Chairman, thank you. I think I will directly defer to the MTRCL to give a PowerPoint presentation on the progress of the three railway extensions before we take questions from members. Thank you. Dr. Wong. Chairman, thank you. We have we do not have any PowerPoint presentation for this part. We've got one for the WIL. The WIL was commissioned in December 2014, and the railway has been running smoothly. For Kee Ling Lane, an exit of Saying Poon Station is carrying out the statutory inspections. We expect that come next month, that is in March, it can be commissioned to the public, including the escalators and lifts. But then the shaft for the escalator has been used for transportation of construction materials in the past few months, and therefore for the escalator, we have to wait until the passenger lift can only be commissioned in the end of this year. But for the other exits, including Zephyr West and Queensborough West, so these exits have got lifts for to provide barrier-free access for those in need to access Tsuen Wan Line station. I now defer to my colleague, Mr. Wong, the General Manager for WIL, and he will brief you on the situation of SIL East. Thank you. Now we're going to use three-car trains linking up MRT and Southern Horizons for connection to the underline and the Tsuen Wan Line at MRT. As at end 2015, the project is 93% completed. Ocean Park Station, Wong Chuk Hang Station, and the depot, we've completed the repair works and the E&M works. And they are now planning for commissioning, and a series of tests are being conducted. the covered pedestrian walkway from Ocean Park to Hon LEUNG Che-cheung Station are now completed. At Alichow, the construction works are still ongoing. The structural works for Lai King Station is completed, and the station for Southern Horizons are more or less completed, and they are now being decorated and EMS facilities. The installation of lifts will also be done. We expect that this will go on until the second quarter of 2016. And for all the track laying in Admiralty and also Ocean Park stations that are completed, within Wong Shou Hang Tsa Po, all the tracks and the tracks are from Ocean City, Ocean Park to Emerald stations are completed and being tested. And for SILEs, the tracks are being tested, and starting from this month, it will be extended to Wong Chuan Station to Admiralty Station. For Admiralty Station, the underpinning works excavation was completed in end 2015. The excavation and refilling works are more or less completed, and the structural fitting out and also E&M installations are going on. The underpinning works of Admiralty Station have encountered challenges. With the hard work of the engineering team, it is now completed. But the remaining works of Admiralty Station, including the structural works, decoration, and E&M, we still have challenges. We will liaise very closely with contractors to ensure that there is sufficient manpower for smooth completion of the works. The corporation is entrusted by the administration to carry out a number of essential infrastructural works. For the covered footbridge in Wong Chau Hang, it is completed and commissioned. And redevelopment of the Wong Chau Hang Nala is also completed. And the new slip road between Ap Lei Chau Lane and is also now commissioned. The underground utilities and expansion of Hengit Road underneath Wong Chau Hang Station will be completed in the first quarter of 2016, and the walkway to Aberdeen Promenade, it will be completed later in the first quarter of this month. And the covered walkway leading Wong Chau Hang Station to the north of Wong Chau Hang will also be completed in the first half of this year. Ocean Park Station, Wong Chau Hang Station, and Wong Chau Hang Depot are now planning for operation. Tests are being done to prepare for commissioning. And Five Lay Chau Station is also progressing smoothly. All tracking works have been completed, and testing has been extended to the section between Wong Chau Hang Station and Admiralty Station, but we still face challenges ahead. The target commissioning date is still end 2016 for SIL East. Thank you. And then the remaining presentation. Can I invite Mr. James Chow to brief you on the progress of KE, current extension. Thank you. Yes, I would like to report to you the latest progress of KTE. It is an extension from Yamate Station to Wangpo with Homantin in between. As at end 2015, the project is 91% completed. This is taken from Chek Ham Do north looking towards Ho Man Tin Station. The major structures were completed last year, and we are installing the E&M and building services and telecommunications and signaling systems. Tests are also being done. We're decorating the station. Nearby, we're carrying out the works on the drains and also other pipes. On the north, I mean in on the left and right bottom top hand, you see the turnstiles, the Congress, so on and so forth. The lower pictures is the control room and also the platform of Kun Tong extension. For the tunnels, the section from Yau Ma Tei to Wang Po have got the structural works and tracking works completed. The overhang lines were also commissioned late last year. Hon LEUNG Station will provide pedestrian linkage. There will be pedestrian subways, footbridges, and also escalators and lifts. As at end 2015, the pedestrian facilities are 96% completed. Improvements of the essential infrastructural works, that is the covered footbridge straddling Checkham Road North. It was gradually opened to the public. Signed from last year, we're working on the cover and the escalators. On the right-hand side, we have two photos showing the footbridges linking Oyman Estate and Shannock Street. They were commissioned to the public late last year. And there is the PTI at Chung Hau Street. The structures are completed and it will be open to the public gradually.
The last station is Wanpo Station. There are the east and west concourses. For the platform subways or tunnels, last year they were completed. And for the concourses, the structure was completed already. And now we are working on E&M installation and renovation. In these pictures, you can see the internal situation of the station. Now here you can see the platform tunnel has been completed and the power supply system has been commissioned. And then on Wan Hoi Street, that part is completed for the tracks and the elevated cables. They are laying already. And then you can see here the E&M installation in the eastern and western concourse. You can see the escalators and also building service installations being underway. For E&M and track testing, the tracks and the elevated cables are completed and is supplied with power. So testing started in January already. Overall speaking, as of end of October 2015, KTE project was over 90% completed, with the Hon LEUNG Che-cheung Station and Wanpo Station structure being completed. Now we are in the final stage of E&M installation and testing. Then our team is working very hard to complete the remaining work. It is expected that in Q3 or Q4 of 2016, the KTE line can be commissioned. Thank you. Thank you. Those who would like to ask questions are as follows: Mr. Tan Ka-biu and Mr. Wong Kwok-hing. Any other members? Mr. Tan Ka-biu, 4 minutes. Thank you. For SIL and KTE, we expect that they can be used by the public this year. This is good news, even though there has been a delay of 1 year or more than 1 year. Some time ago, we talked about exceedance of budget on many infrastructural projects. But if you look at WIL, SIL, and KTE, there's exceedance of budget. And for WIL, 20% exceedance. SIL and KTE, one-third exceedance of budget, more than 30%. Even though MTRC is going to pay the exceedance, have you already anticipated such exceedance? Have you analyzed the reasons? In the future, will the fares and concessions be affected? For SIL and KTE, well, they are extensions, so there will be restriction on the fares, but will the fare level be affected? And what is the role of the government given this kind of ownership model? Secretary, yes, let me comment on the broad principles, and MTRC and Highways Department colleagues can supplement. For WIL, SILE, and KTE, they are being done on the basis of ownership. MTRC owns and builds the projects, and MTRC is responsible for the engineering expenses. So the building and future operational risks will be shouldered by MTRC. Now construction cost has gone up. In the future, if passenger volume and fare level is lower than expectation, MTRC will be there to take the risk. Because of this ownership model, as regards fare level, as you said, these are extensions. So existing fares will be the reference points in calculating the new fares. Well, the details can be supplemented later, but that's basically the mode. MTRC colleague, please supplement. Dr. Wong, thank you, Chairman. Regarding fares, there is another mechanism to adjust the fares. So, it is totally not related to the increase in construction costs. Just now, Mr. Tang said that there is an increase in construction cost for these lines. Let me explain. For KTE, it is in a very dense community. And the same applies to SIL. There is quite a long section which entails tunnel excavation. So in the design stage of the project, we used existing information to work out the design. But during construction phase for both projects, we encountered unforeseeable factors. So that's why construction was affected, and we had to modify our work. In the past 2 years, we monitored the challenges in the project, and we adjusted the construction expenses correspondingly. All right. So not all your questions have been answered. Well, you can wait for your next turn. Mr. Wong Kwok Hing. Thank you, Chairman. As a directly elected member for Hong Kong Island, I am very concerned about the progress of SIL. So I have a series of questions to ask. I hope to get your response. First, at the end of the year, the lines will be commissioned. Can you give us an exact date? Number two, with an exact date, then before commissioning of the line, can a certain period be set aside, for example, a few days or 1 week for passengers to visit and try the service for free, as in the case of WIL, so that passengers can get familiar with the environment, because during morning peak hours, it will be very busy. The third question is, before commissioning of the service, can members of this subcommittee or other logical members who are interested be given the opportunity to do a site visit of the SIL? Of course, this should be done only when the project is totally completed. We don't want to cause any obstruction to your work. Now the projects are almost finished, then in South Horizons, Aptly Chow Estate and Lay Tong Estate, what is the progress of the road restoration? I hope that nuisance to nearby residents and to road traffic can be minimized as much as possible. So can specific dates be given? As we all know, for SIL, it is an automatic system, a driverless system, and there are three cars train. But then if during busy hours, if the service is not enough, is there still room to increase trains? That's all. So I will defer to MTRC colleague Dr. Wong. Thank you, Chairman. As reported just now, over 90%, actually 93% of the SIL has been completed. Based on what we know, the E&M installation for a number of stations has yet to be completed, and then there are some tests to be done. Now, our goal is to have the lines commissioned before the end of this year. We will monitor the progress together with the government, and we will give regular report to this subcommittee. At a certain point in time, if we know the exact commissioning date, then we will consider the example of WIL to offer some passengers and members of the public the opportunity to visit certain stations or try the service. We were also happy to arrange members of this subcommittee to visit some of the stations, especially those stations that have been completed. This can be arranged. As regards road reinstatement, we are now in the process, especially in the urban area. Chairman, can they cope with the people flow? Well, based on our estimate for a three-car train at the existing frequency, the service should be enough. When there is the need, we will consider increasing service frequency. So there are three cars. You can't add additional cars. Because of the design of the station, only three cars are possible. Chairman, can they work with the department to arrange a visit as soon as possible? Yes, thank you. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, Chairman, Dr. Wong said that if there is loss or exceedance of budget, well, this is totally not related to fare adjustment. Why is that so? Is it true that there is a mechanism that if you incur a loss, you will borrow money from the market or you will do a share placement? But still, we are talking about government's money. Is that what you mean? Any other questions? Because he said that it's totally not related. So have you asked all your questions? I would like to deal with this question first because I am really shocked. Dr. Wong, Chairman, I will ask my colleague Ms. Wong to answer the question. Ms. Wong, thank you, Chairman, and thank you, Member, for the question. For the new lines, we have to consider many factors in determining the fares. For example, in the district, whether there are other modes of transport. Chairman, I think she has misunderstood my question. I'm not referring to the new lines. If you have incurred a loss, overall speaking, will other lines be affected? Let's say if you have lost 10 billion in construction, then will the loss be split up among other lines? Will you increase fares to make up for the loss? or you cannot do that because of the mechanism. Yes, you are asking for the relationship between the project cost and the fare. I'm not referring to this new line. I'm referring to the overall picture. Ms. Chen, yes, Chairman, I guess I have misunderstood the question. Thank you for the question. Just now, our director said already that project cost, let's say if there is any increase in project cost, that will not affect fare determination mechanism. Okay, then she said that if there is a slight increase in cost, it does not affect fare level. But if there is a big increase, then what? Are you going to issue debts? Otherwise, there won't be the incident about the Canton, Shenzhen, Hong Kong rail. The government will have to pay the bill eventually. Well, we will talk about that later. Now, do they mean that no matter how much they have lost in the projects, the fare determination will not be affected? Of course, I hope that this will be the case. They won't increase fares no matter how big a loss that they have incurred. Is this really the mechanism? They just said that for this line, that won't be the case. And later on, they said if the loss is more, then fares won't be affected. Okay, please do not copy Leung Chen-ying in the way in your way of speaking. Undersecretary, members, perhaps you can refer to some past information from us. For fare increase or decrease, fare adjustment, every year they will do one fare adjustment, and there is a formula. We work according to the formula. And factors of consideration are inflation in Hong Kong, changes in wages in the transport sector. These are the factors. And we will not consider the cost of certain projects
in
making fare adjustments. Mr. Tony C. In relation to paragraph 14 of the paper, they said that on the 12th of August last year, the corporation told the administration that the construction costs have to be adjusted upwards, and then for the SEL, the cost will be increased by about $1.3 billion. Of course, the Highways Department will examine the latest cost estimate with its assistance, I mean with its consultant, because of the experience learned from XRL. But usually, the corporation submits information rather too slow and incomprehensively. So I'd like to ask whether the administration will be able to see that, and what lesson has it learned from previous experience to ensure that when it comes to the timeliness and completion of information obtained, you can do better. Undersecretary, Director of Highways, we're told by the corporation that the project cost would be increased, and as pointed out by the member, we are now seeking further information from the corporation. We wanted to be available earlier, but we do understand that this expansion of Admiralty Station involves very complicated works. And regarding the reasons for the project higher project cost, is because of the underpinning works of the existing tunnel of the island line. It is rather complicated and will allow time for cooperation to put together information required. What about the delay or the delay in submitting information? I think that's what Mr. Tony Z meant. First, the works have not suffered any delay. It is now in progress, and as we said, the underpinning works have been completed. Structural works is being done at the station. There is no delay in work, and is progressing according to its schedule. And for the costs or the data, we will ask them for them, and we will only pay the bills when such figures are available. So we will press them to give us detailed information as soon as possible. The administration indicated earlier that there's limited manpower within the highways department. Of course, we have to cap the cost for XRL. And I believe here the cost will not increase too much further, because that $1.3 billion will be for the administration to pay. I believe the highways demand department has seen preliminary information and is asking for more detailed information. I hope that the corporation can be more cooperative, and please do not require the administration to press you for information. For WIL, at first there was water seepage. And then we have to summon the winter now, and according to the observatory, the coming summer will be very wet. And we're told by some passengers that water seepage is found, water dripping even is found in some stations. So I'd like to know how the defects have been rectified, and have you found out the cause of water leakage, or if you just adopted stopgap approach, you know, the fundamental solution is to find out the cause of water seepage. Thank you. After the commissioning of the WIL, we've followed up on water seepage on the pedestrian subways. The major reasons were some of the rainwater has to be channeled back to the drains, but some of the rainwater could not be channeled away in time. And for most of the tunnels or subways, they do have rainwater. It's just that it has to be channeled into the drains. So we have followed up on how rainwater was gathered the ceiling. So for stopgap measures, we only did it at very selected spots. Because for a water ceiling, we sometimes use grouting, and at some locations, grouting was not done very completely, and other waterproofing works have been done. We are very closely monitoring the situation. We understand that the rainy season has set in a little earlier. There's been some rain during the winter, but so far we have not seen any water seepage. We will, however, closely monitor the situation. Structurally speaking, water seepage can be a serious problem. It may affect the reinforced concrete in the future. Was there something wrong with the design or the construction? Will you investigate and even pursue responsibility? Water seepage was not related to the structure, because it was just at isolated spots of waterproofing that had to be followed up on. And the water seepage has nothing to do with the structure. And so we are just improving or tidying up the defects in waterproofing. Now for XE, the cost overrun is $7.5 million, or rather $75 million. I'd like to know the reason for that, because this is quite a big amount of money. Can you tell us the major reasons for the cost overrun? That $75 million cost overrun was due to some essential infrastructures. Can Mr. Chow please supplement? Yes, there is a cost overrun of $75 million for the EIFW, because we have encountered complicated geological conditions in drain tunnels, and we have to install fire services, installations, and at the request of the local community, we have covered the pedestrian footbridges, and these were not envisaged in when the project was planned. Mr. Tan Kapiu, I'd like to follow on my previous questions. Now, three railway lines together will lead to a cost overrun of over $9 billion. $9.5 billion. That is a cost overrun of over 30%. We find this problematic. You may say that the XRL was unique, and the government was also negligent in monitoring the project. But for these projects here, they are all ownership projects. The corporation is supposed to have be more stringent with budget control. Now, take Lohas Town or the Lohas Station. I'd like to know whether there was any cost overrun. We have seven railway lines planned, and the administration is negotiating with the corporation. Is the latter willing to take up these projects, or would they rather ask the administration to underwrite all the construction works? Would the cost overrun here affect the seven railway lines in the pipeline, including Tung Chung West, and which I am very concerned about? How will the seven lines be constructed? Are we going to entrust it to the MTRCL? Even so, how will be the financing mode? What would be the financing mode? We have to reconsider this again. We'll see whether it should be in the concession model or ownership model. We will consider which one is better. Of course, both have their pros and cons. And some members are concerned about how the cost overrun will be absorbed. Different railway lines can be done differently. And for these three railways, this is the first time we have the ownership model. So we have to learn from this experience. We are undecided as to the arrangement of the future railways. And if members have suggestions, we are happy to hear them. MTRCL. If I may say so, MTRCL has been carrying out railway construction at different stages. For Chung Kwan L station is at a newly developed areas, but for these lines in question, they are in densely populated and already built up areas in town. Our engineering team will of course design a project according to information they have at hand, but when it comes to the construction, there might be unforeseeable changes. In the past few years, we have seen major changes in the objective environment. For instance, too many infrastructure projects happening and also increase in wages. And all these have caused the construction costs to rise. Will of course reconsider all new railways in the future. I didn't hear you. Whether there was any cost overrun for the Zhangquan O Line and Lohas Station. I gather there wasn't. But will this affect your international rating? Because you are also contracting many international railway lines. If I may share with you my experience, I'm a professional engineer and I have liaison with many international institutes. For instance, the Chartered Association of Civil Engineers in the UK, they have very high regard for our performance in carrying out complicated projects, and they have commended us in their publications. Since members are very concerned about cost overrun, the reasons, and all how they will be funded, so can the MTRCL help us in the following areas? Can we be given a list containing the amount of cost overrun, the reasons, and also the funding mode for recent railways for our information? Mr. Tang said that according to his calculation, the cost overrun for these three lines was $9.5 billion. Now, I would like to clarify. We said that in the original APE, we used money of we use the construction cost in the prevailing year's prices, but here we'll talk about money of the day prices, so this is not really a like to like comparison. Using a like to like comparison in money of the day prices, the total cost overrun is $6 billion for all three lines. So that's included. That includes price adjusted causes. So the cost overrun is about 16%.
Your government.
Can the government provide us with that paper? Yes. Some other members would like a site visit before the commissioning of SIL. Can you help? Yes. If there is no further question, let's move on to the next item about Sha Tin Central Link. Can NTRC brief us on the paper? Does the Undersecretary have anything to say? Well, I will defer to the company. Oh, okay. So there are other representatives coming in. Now, we have already finished discussing the first agenda item on SIL, WIL, and KTE. Now we are on Sha Tin to Central Link, SEL, the latest progress. MTRC, please. Thank you. For SEL, I will ask our General Manager, Mr. Lee, to brief members. Chairman, members, good morning. In the past few months, the SEL project is underway smoothly. 48% of the project has been completed as of the end of October last year, and for East and West Corridor, 63% of it has been completed from Hinking to Ma Chai Hang and Lion Rock Tunnel. In November, early November last year, these parts were connected, and for Hinkeng and Kai Tak stations, the top has been made already, and then for the tunnel, 80% has been completed. It is expected that it will be completed totally in August this year. Even though we are still in early stage, but then for CEC station and also the tunnel excavation, works have started already. For east-west and north-south corridors, they are in line with the completion dates of 2019 and 2022. For the latest progress, at this moment, more than half of the project has been completed, actually 51%. Credit has to go to our engineering team. Now, I will defer to my colleague Jason to brief you on the progress of each section. Mr. Wong, thank you, Chairman and members. Let me first comment on the stations. For Hinking and Kai Tak Station, well, we are now moving into the E&M stage from the civil engineering stage. And the elevated bridge had already been completed on the ground surface. We are doing excavation and also the tunnel structure for Kai Tak Station. The backfilling work has been completed. We are doing structural work on the two sides. And in the station, we are doing renovation, track laying, and E&M works. In Sha Tin to Wong Tai Shin, linking Hinking and Kai Tak stations, the length is 5 kilometers. That is a tunnel, and in November last year, it was through already, connecting Sha Tin and the Wong Tai Shin station, this section. And after blasting work, we are now working on the internal structure from ground surface to Lion Rock Tunnel. Last year, at the end of last year, we completed the excavation works. 30% of the works for Diamond Hill to Ma Chai Hang had been completed, and we hope that this year the remaining parts can be completed. And in December, tracks were being laid already. For Diamond Hill Station, the platform has more or less been completed. For the whole station structure in Q2, basically it will be completed. Connecting Diamond Hill and Kai Tak, the tunnel was completed in October last year, and now we are building the links and the access roads. The most complicated and challenging part is the Kowloon City section. From Kai Tak to To Kwa Wan Tunnel, 80% of the tunnel structure was completed. And then the structure work started in September last year. The tunnel towards Ho Man Tin had now been connected to Ma Ta Wai Station, and over 70% of the drilling works have been completed. In Q2 this year, it will reach Ho Man Tin Station. For drilling and excavation, more than 40% of the works have been completed. For Ma Ta Wai Station, structural work was completed in November last year. Now we are doing the structural work. More than two-thirds of excavation was completed. From Ho Man Tin to Hong Ham Tunnel, excavation was completed in November last year. We are now on tunnel structure. 70% of the works have been completed. Hong Ham section. In Hong Ham Station, the South Concourse redevelopment had been completed. In Q1 this year, it will be commissioned. And then we will close the North Concourse very soon. And then for the newly built platform, we are now doing excavation and structural works. And for the train depot, more than 60% of the internal structure has been completed. For Cross Harbour section, we are now producing the 11 prefabricated units. And for the island section, the former police club part had been demolished. And then for the tunnel units, they are being assembled. And then very soon, we will start to do excavation and drilling for the tunnel. For HKCEC station, the nearby roads in the first half of this year will be such that there will be temporary traffic management measures. The Wan Chai swimming pool had been demolished, and space was set out for the new stadium. For the new trains, for East-West and North-South Corridor, they have been sent to Hong Kong, and now they are in Pat Heung and Ho Tong Lau Depot for very stringent tests. And there will be test runs soon. For the first 8-car train, which is a modification, it has already been commissioned in January this year. For some parts of the railway station, especially the Ma Wan Shan station, the superstructure has been completed. We are now working on E&M and renovation. And then at Tai Wai, there we have already installed the automatic platform screen doors for other stations as well. We are reinforcing the platform, and then we are building signal room and other facilities. For signaling system test, we are now doing this work. We don't want to affect train service, so we have to do it during small hours of the day. For Patheng Depot, most of the facilities have been commissioned. As of the end of December 2015, progress of SEL is 48% completion. Because of delay from the archaeological work, the expected commission dates can still be 2019 and 2022 for East-West, North-South corridor, respectively. There are still a lot of challenges in Hong Kong, but the engineering team will continue to ride out the difficulties and review the progress, and we will announce the details in due course. Thank you. Those who would like to ask questions are Mr. Tan Ka Biu, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, Mr. KK Kwok, Mr. Tan Ka Biu.
对，主席，即系我哋见到沙中线。
Thank you, Chairman. For SEL, the progress is not bad. Of course, there is the archaeological issue, and cost overrun is inevitable. But will you seek funding approval from LegCo? If so, when? In the past 2 to 3 months, there were a lot of news and incidents that is in the existing East Rail Line platforms. There were people falling down from the platform. So do you have to wait till 2019 in retrofitting the platform screen door? Can you do it earlier? Can you add platform screen doors earlier to protect passenger safety? Because there are 1 to 2 incidents every month, and every time the consequence was very serious. Train service was also affected. Is it possible to retrofit platform screen door on East Rail sooner? At some stations, for example, Mongkok East, Hong Ham, can there be special arrangement in view of the signaling system? Thank you. Undersecretary, Chairman, let me answer Mr. Tang's first question. As he pointed out, for SEL, there is cost overrun on certain items. As Mr. Tang said, this is related to archaeology and conservation. As I said on the last item, for Admiralty and Homantin stations, the actual construction costs, well, for the SEL portion, there is an increase. And for the superstructure of Hong Kong CEC station, there is increase in project costs. As a result, total costs will go up. As we discussed on the last item, last year in August, MTRCL said already that for the expansion of the Admiralty Station, there will be an increase of commitment of 1.3 billion. And now we are seeking additional information from MTRC, and when the information is available, we'll submit the information to the Highways Department for them to verify, and in due course, we will come to LegCo to ask for additional funding. I will defer to MTRC to answer the second question. Dr. Wong, thank you, Chairman. On installation of platform screen doors on East Rail, in November 2013, we reported to this subcommittee. East Rail is a rather old line, so there are different procedures to follow. We have to consider the gap at the platform, and the platform cannot tolerate the weight of the screen door. Now we are trying to decrease the gap, and we are reinforcing the platform structure. We are underway, and progress is satisfactory. After that, We have to add signaling system facilities and rooms. So we can only start to install platform screen doors in 2019. Besides, East Rail is operating, so every night we only have 3 hours to do the work. We have to coordinate with our operations team, so our time is really tight. Okay, so you are underway. Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, Chairman. The British said that the Parliament cannot turn men into women. Apart from that, everything is possible. But then LegCo is not the same. We have no power. For the large enterprises like MTRC, well, they can even turn men into women. You said you did not consider platform screen door in the design, so the platforms cannot tolerate the weight of the screen door and there is gap. And then all along we are not in the know. Now, if you go to Taipei, you can see that there are platform screen doors for all stations. And you haven't considered that when you designed the line. And now you are saying to us that this is not possible. You are saying that we are forcing you. So that's the reason for filibustering. If we did not give you funding approval without the platform screen doors, well, you would not confront us because of this minor detail. So that's why we really cannot monitor you. It's up to you to say whatever you like. There are deaths. Mr. Leung, he said that the work is underway. He didn't say that they won't do it. But then the point is, it's very difficult. At the beginning, if the concrete is better, if the gap is smaller, then that will be better. Well, there are reasons behind filibustering. Everybody is so anxious now. And you just talked about the factors for fare increase. Now I understand. All the factors are created by themselves. One Belt, One Road in Hong Kong, I think the concept is the same. So you are building all these lines together regardless of the circumstances. So as a result, there is this uptrend.
The CPI, of course, will increase construction wages, of course, and also medium family income, of course, will increase. And so you come up with the result of fare increase using a formula. This formula can be adopted at least until 2030, because all these have been increasing. We have no control over your losses. We are using public money to fund your operation. So I think we are drinking poison to quench our thirst. But we talk about the SCL. Yes, SCL will be just the same. What control do you have over the corporation? Now, if you say they will be penalized, the senior management of the corporation will see their salaries or bonus cut if the accounts are not good, or they will have to be sacked, then they will do nothing of this kind. Yes, I might have digressed a little bit, but I think I have hit the nail on his head. It's really, we really have no control over them. Neither you nor I are experts in our railway. Now, they told us that it cannot be done. So I'd like to know whether it is really infeasible to have the platform screen doors. Now, even a dog would disrupt your service for a few hours, and you were also scolded afterwards. Now, if the mesh wire is not operating, so can you really install the platform screen doors? Well, if Mr. Leung read the paper, he will see that for East Rail, we will certainly install platform screen door. It's just that we have to tie with the works for SEL because that involves an adjustment of the communication system. The platforms of the Israel were constructed in the 1980s, last century, and therefore the platforms could not withstand the weight of platform screen doors, and therefore we have to alter the platforms first. In the 1980s, even the members were not here, so filibustering would not change the situation. So we'll talk about alterations to the platforms and also the communications or signaling lines before screen doors can be installed. This will be done. It is not infeasible. Dr. Kwakaki, neither the administration nor the corporation has answered the question of the amount of cost overrun and when the program can be completed. Because a few railway projects of the corporation are fighting for labor. And you are party to this increase in wages because your works are competing for manpower. And this is not the first time we've seen cost overrun and project delays. And I don't think we are very confident with the program of SEL. Can the administration tell us whether the calculated cost overrun is already final? When can it be final? And as for the heritage site at Kai Tak, archaeological site at Kai Tak, can there be any public engagement in design and conservation so that you can do it better? And in your stations, people criticize you for not providing public toilets. So for Hinkin and Hong Kong and Kai Tak, I'd like to know the state of provision of public toilets inside the turnstiles and outside. All right, I'll answer the first and second questions, and the corporation will talk about the toilets. Cost overrun. As I said, the cost overrun of SEL involves a number of factors, including the archaeological and conservation works at Tokwa Wan Station. And on Hong Kong Island, Admiralty Station and Homantin Station, and also increased in cost for development of the exhibition station. There are different reasons for cost overrun for different stations. We're waiting for more detailed information from the corporation who said that they expect to have it completed by the second quarter of this year for scrutiny by the Highways Department. We then report to the Council or apply for increased funding from the Council after we have got those accounts. And they have already completed a tunnel and the underground conditions are rather clear. The most uncertain factors in such projects is geological conditions. I think they are more certain about the geological conditions now. For conservation, it involves $4.1 billion. There will not be too many changes to this figure, subject to a further verification. But we're looking for breakdown from them. We do not just look at the sum total, so it will take time for them to prepare the details. As for Kai Tak, we followed the requirements of the AMO and the archaeological sites have been protected by covering it with soil. So when the works are completed, we will then deal with the site. Can the public be involved, and in what way we will have to defer to the relevant department? Of course, if members have suggestions, we can relate them to the relevant department. Can you provide a brief response to the third question? I invite Mr. Wong to talk about the public toilets. In new railways, all stations will provide public toilet facilities. So all toilets of, all station of CSL will have toilets. I'm asking you about the numbers and also the ratio between the provision for male and female passengers. Mr. Lee Chuk-yen, for XLL, they're going to import 70 workers tentatively. I don't know whether that will be changed. For CSL, do you have any plans to import foreign labor? Thank you. Importation of labor would depend on the needs of the works and the trades involved. Yes, we're applying for importation of some E&M workers. It's still in the application stage. For all supplementary labor scheme, vetting has to be done by the LAB. And while we apply for foreign labor, we'll have to try to recruit local workers. And application for foreign labor can only be approved if we failed in local recruitment. How many EMS workers are you going to import? And for XLL and this project, you both need EMS workers. Is it because you're competing for the same trade at roughly the same time? And if for SCL and XLL would both apply for EMN workers, can you apply for one badge for sharing between the two projects? Well, both projects have EMM works going on at the same time. For SCL, structural works in some stations are already completed and E&M installations have to start. The same applies for XLL. Under the supplementary labor scheme, the same contractor can deploy their workers to different work sites so long as it is specified in the application. So the same batch of EM workers can work in both SCL and XLL sites, depending on the decision of the contractor. Well, what about the number of foreign workers required for SCL? For XLL, I think it is 70. I think SCL is applying for about 70 foreign E&M workers. So it's meaningless to say that you're applying for 140 E&M foreign workers. Well, if two contractors are involved, that is true. Mr. Gary Fan, we've seen cost overrun and delay in all corporation projects. And addition of public toilets and also installation of platform screen doors, we've also seen slippage. And therefore, the corporation should be criticized. It's making a lot of money, so it's not that it doesn't have the resources, and therefore we must criticize the corporation for these failings. Now there's the Hinking Shopping Mall and 8 old-style Y-type PRH, and there is Garting Court and Old Harmony Building. The passenger circulation at Hinking Station was surely increased greatly with the commissioning of SCL, and the traveling pattern of passengers would also change. And I think they have reflected to you that if you have a pedestrian footbridge linking up with Hinking Shopping Mall, that will not just offer convenience to passengers, but you will also greatly enhance pedestrian safety. And it will also be a convenient link for residents of Hinking Estate, but the administration has refused to do it, quoting insufficient circulation. You still had about 6-9 years for the project, and the railway is delayed due to archaeological finds. It is better you do it now than to wait until you retrofit it, when you discover that the circulation between the station and Hinking has increased. Now, if you do it now, or you do it after the station is commissioned, do you think that the project cost will also be high? Corporation. Thank you, Mr. Fan, for your question. We've been following up with the local community. I will invite my colleague, Mr. Wong, to comment. Thank you, Mr. Fan. Pedestrian footbridge facilities for Hinking Station. We have already given an account at a closed-door meeting in Lechko. In 2031, by 2031, according to projections, there is still a certain spare capacity in that junction to deal with pedestrian needs, so long as we enhance the green light phase and also increase pedestrian crossing facilities, we'll be able to cope.
We have already given an account during the closed session, and there is no more follow-up item. Chairman, for nearby residents and passengers, well, they know that very soon Hinking Station will be completed, and they may change their future traveling patterns. I think this kind of request is reasonable. And for other stations along the line, there are public and private housing, shopping malls, and so on. In those stations, there are precedents in which there is pedestrian connections or footbridge. So why can't this be done? Well, let me supplement very quickly. For pedestrian facility, we will refer to traffic volume and the related arrangement. Che-cheung Mill Road is at its end already at that part, and traffic serves Hinking mainly. Traffic volume is relatively lower as compared to other areas. So in the future, well, in 2031, the crossing facilities will be enough to cope with the situation. We think that there are enough pedestrian crossing facilities, but it's less safe. Now, since you are able to offer safer environment for the pedestrians, well, they patronize you. They go to Hinking Station to take the SCL. Well, can you follow up in the next round? Dr. KK Kwok, 2 minutes. Chairman, the Undersecretary referred to the Kai Tak Station, and you said that now some mud is used to cover things up, and in terms of the construction, in terms of the design, I think, first of all, we have to protect the heritage. Besides, when future monuments are displayed, well, I think that it should tie in with the station. Why can't this be done earlier? And you said that cost involved is 4 billion. Does this figure include the reprovisioning of the monuments and the exhibition? Can MTRC explain more about toilets in stations and how many will be there? Will the toilets be in positions after passengers have crossed the gate or before? I guess MTRC can explain more about the station where heritage is found. And then for the 4.1 billion, it is purely because money has to be spent in protection and associated expenses. In the future, will a gallery be set up to protect the heritage? Well, that is about conservation and exhibition, and those expenses are not included in the project cost. Yes, I understand. I'm asking about the design. If things done now are irreversible, then there will be a waste of money then. Okay, I will ask MTRC to explain and also answer the point about toilets. MTRC? Okay, because no one else is on the line, so you can give more details. So should I now comment on heritage or toilets? Both. Okay. There is an ancient well, which is conserved in situ. And near the ancient well, there are also other monuments. And now we are working with AAB to see how to work out the design around the station. There are some antiquities which are being removed, but then later on they will be reprovisioned at the same station. That's the existing arrangement. I'm asking whether there will be things that are irreversible in your design. Then in the future, you will be wasting a lot more money. Now, the government has the responsibility, even though you do not belong to the same bureau. Okay, for example, in the future, if a lot of things have to be removed before going to Kai Tak Station, then a lot of time and money will be wasted. Why can't you do it at one go? Okay, this is a follow-up question from Mr. Kwok. And please give the information, and also please give information on toilets before or after the turnstiles. Now we are working with the AAB for the monuments and antiquities. All of them can be preserved at particular spots. For toilets, yes, there is the ratio between male and female toilets, but then concerning the actual number of compartments in the washroom, we can provide you with the information later on. Okay, now let's move on to the next item. Progress update on the Hong Kong section of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen Hong Kong Express Rail Link. So I guess there will be some other government officials attending this item. Okay, may I invite the government officials to come in? Secretary, will you first give a briefing? Okay, let them settle down first. Okay, we can begin. Mr. Yao Sheng Mu, can you please give a briefing, and then MTRC representatives will do a PowerPoint presentation. Please seize the time. Yes, thank you, Chairman. Let me first give a very brief introduction. Chairman, we are now formally presenting the progress report as of the 31st of December 2015. This is a quarterly report on the progress of Hong Kong section of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Rail Link. In recent FCs and PWSC meetings, we had already briefly explained the latest progress. Last year, on the 30th of June, MTRC presented to the government on the amended target completion dates and also the budget estimates. After detailed deliberation on the 30th of November last year, the review results were announced, and the latest budget is being adjusted downward from 83 billion to 84.42 billion. In terms of project completion dates, both parties agreed that it should be amended to third quarter of 2018, and there is a buffer of 6 months. Since the last quarterly report, Highways Department and MTRC worked on the amended completion date of Q3 of 2018. As of end December last year, the progress is such that 76% of the project was completed, and comparing with the progress on the revised timetable, which states 74%, it is now faster than expected. So basically, we are working towards all the expected completion days. Progress is now better, but as the Highways Department consultant said, revision of the completion date is not risk-free. It's not risk-free. We have to coordinate with the contractors to make sure that the assumed workload and the arrangements are all feasible, so that construction problems and risk are under control and can be resolved. Chairman, we are now at the most critical moment of this project. We need funding approval, additional funding approval from LegCo. This is really very urgent because we are very close to the deadline. The increase in funding application had been discussed two times for 4 hours. In November last year, we got the support from this subcommittee. After that, there were six PWSC meetings for 13 and a half hours. At the request of some members, we produced 2 and 8 supplementary reports to this subcommittee and PWSC. It is very urgent that we get additional funding approval. At the end of this week or 1 week later, we have to seriously consider whether we need to suspend work. If work is suspended, the consequence will be very serious. There will be big cost overrun. At the same time, the commission date will be delayed significantly. Based on our supplementary information paper, you can see that if the project is to be suspended and if the contract has to be terminated, cost overrun will be around 4.8 billion. This is just a conservative estimate. Now, if the government cannot get funding approval, we have to set aside funds to make sure that total cost will be within the commissioning amount of 65 billion. If the total cost is approaching 60 billion, we have to consider whether we have to suspend works. As of the 31st of December last year, accumulated commitment of all the contracts is 52.2 billion, and then insurance, expenses, other miscellaneous costs. For the Hong Kong section, the total expenses will be 57.6 billion. Based on MTRC's information, as of this March, total cost will reach 60.2 billion. So, at the end of this week or next Monday, if we still don't know whether we can get additional funding, then the government must seriously consider the financial position of SRL. And we have to decide on when we need to suspend works. At that time, we will have a more accurate understanding of the total cost. Now, in view of this deadline, we have considered all the pros and cons, and that's why we directly submitted the additional funding application to FC, even though PWSC has not completed deliberation. So far, FC has spent 12 hours on it. Now, more than three-quarters of the project has been completed. The Highways Department and also the consultant will continue to monitor the remaining progress to make sure that within the revised timetable, XRL can be completed and commissioned. Then we can have all the economic benefits and social benefits realized. I would like to appeal to members to approve our additional funding application at FC as soon as possible. Now, I will ask MTRC to do a PowerPoint presentation. Who would speak from MTRC? I will ask our General Manager, Tsuen Wan Line, to take you through the latest progress. Chairman, thank you. Now, let me report to you the latest progress. As of 2016, end of January, progress is in line with expectation. 77.3% was completed. Expected progress is 75%. For civil engineering works, completion was 83.7%. Expected completion is 81.2%. E&M works, completion is 52.8%. Expected progress is 50.8%. Tunnel works, for the last two sections, that is, machines are to be used to build the tunnel from Huanggang to Mai Po, and also Tai Kong Po to Cheok Chun northbound line. On the 4th of November and 12th of December, these sections were commissioned respectively. So that means all the tunnel excavation works for 26-kilometer length was completed.
For the civil engineering works of the tunnel, after the tunnels are excavated, then there will be tracks laying over headlines and signal systems and communication systems to be done. The total length is 72.8 kilometers, and over 65% of the tracks are laid already. Along the tunnel, there are seven ventilation shafts. Five have got their structural works completed in the fourth quarter of last year. The remaining two shafts in Yuen Long and Ao Tam Mei and Chun Man Sheng Wen, respectively, as at January this year, the ventilation building already 83.7% and 99.2% completed. And for the internal fitting out works of the depot and emergency rescue point at Shekong, they are more or less completed. And the signaling system, the ventilation system, so on and so forth, and are also more or less completed. For the EMM, the building services installation are about 72% complete. The ventilation system, the ventilation shafts, and telecation equipment are being installed. There are 23 units of 11,000 volt of transforming facilities. They are already completed in the first, in the last quarter of last year. And for the critical part of the section, that is entrance of the terminus, the underpinning works, nine units were totally installed in the last quarter of 2015. And the installation of temporary steel structures that were completed, and the progress has been very satisfactory, is 62.8% over against the planned completion rate of 36.5%, and for the V-shape horizontal beams, all 12 7 of the 12 units were installed in January, and we expect all of them completed within the second quarter of this year. Civil engineering works of West Kowloon Terminus as at end January. The overall excavation works were 97.8% completed. Concrete structural works 73.1% completed against the planned progress of 97.6% and 70.3%. The blasting work on the northern platform of the terminus is expected to be completed in the first quarter of this year. The EMM works within the terminus, about 28.2% of the GFA have been handed over to the contractor of EMM for installation. For installation of building services, escalators and lifts at different levels. As at end January, the building services within West Kowloon Terminus have been 41.3% more or less on a par with the planned program. So the whole project is about three quarters completed. Most of the uncertain factors are now certain. We will closely monitor the progress and will urge the contractors to take forward the projects as planned to meet the target completion date as far as possible. Our plan is to have the works completed by the third quarter of 2018. Thank you. I open the floor to members for questions. Also, we will receive questions on the progress of the XRL because the FS is also vetting funding applications. So for questions are meant for the FC, please do not raise them here because this session will be mainly devoted to the progress of works. Kwaka Ki Loa Kwok, James Michael Tien, Wu Chi Wai, Li Chuk Yen. 5 minutes each, please. Dr. Kwaka Ki, thank you. $80 billion for 26 kilometers tunnel. The unit construction cost is among the highest in the world. Both the corporation and the administration have to share the responsibility. And according to paragraph 24, there are a lot of works not yet claimed. So we are like an ATM. While works are going on, the corporation is directly or indirectly asking for money from the government. According to workers, the contractors are doing it very sluggishly. Perhaps they are waiting for claims. And if this is to continue, I don't think we can complete the works worth $20 odd billion. So my question for the Highways Department is, of course, I think the biggest responsibility should be borne by the director, by the Highways Department. If you do not monitor the works properly, you are just allowing contractors to treat you like ATMs. Given that there are such reports, how can you convince us that the contractors are acting in good faith? Chairman, you like to talk about the number of luncheon meats that can be bought. Now, the money here, they are taxpayers' money. And cost overrun and project delays continue. Given that it's up to $20 billion, shouldn't the MTR Corporation be responsible? The senior management are still getting tens of millions of dollars in pay. Shouldn't the government do something about that? And for the superstructure of the terminus, I'm quite worried about the glass ceiling, because it's part of the reason leading to the cost overrun. It's also very complicated work-wise. So, in fact, the terminus doesn't have to be so pretty. You're making it White Elephant project in order to dovetail with the style of the mainland stations. So can you tell us the risk, the cost overrun, and the delay involved when it comes to the design of the terminus? Now, first, the reasons for the delay. The corporation has commissioned an independent expert to give us a report. It is pointed out that during the works, there were unforeseen geological conditions. Well, there was outrageous because it was all the way from 1997. And that's the reason given by the expert report. As for claims, Mr. Kwok has pointed out the amount of claims. But that doesn't mean that the corporation has pay all the claims, because these are just claims from contractors thinking that they are eligible to claim this amount of money. As the manager of the project, the MTRCL has the responsibility to deal with claims from contractors. This is the fundamental responsibility of the corporation as the manager of the project. Contractors are required to justify their claims with sufficient information. And upon receipt of such claims, the corporation has the duty to vet these claims very meticulously to see if they are really reasonable. But there are reports, even workers can tell you, that the workers are not really working very hard in these in the site. They are just waiting to see claims. So if you send people to check to see whether the contractors are really only doing it half-heartedly, as I said, for all claims, the contractors have to prove that they have done their level best to minimize the extra cost. For instance, they cannot put workers there without working to seek claims. Mr. Lo Wai Kwok, on the 13th of December last year, together with a few LegCo members, we visited the WK terminus of XRL, and we're told that the day before we paid the visit, that is the 12th of December, the tunnel was entirely connected, was entirely open. According to the paper, you more or less followed the scheduled progress, or even a little bit ahead of schedule. But this schedule has already been adjusted, and the adjusted commissioning date is the third quarter of 2018. Of course, the project slippage and overrun are rather serious, but to be pragmatic or to be fair, you have a you are a little bit ahead of schedule. At least this is some progress. I'm quite concerned about the structural works of the entrance of the West Kowloon Terminus, because engineers from the corporation gave us a special briefing because it was a very huge ceiling with complicated columns and beams. According to the report, all the V-shaped horizontal beams can be installed within the second quarter of this year. However, many engineers have some worries about the remaining works because it is a very complicated 3D structure. You have the beams and columns, and the structure is rather irregular. And the units to be installed are also irregular in shape. So this is a very big challenge. So can you tell us what is the situation like now? Have you got a solution for all of the challenges so that you will not have further delays? Cooperation. Dr. Wang? Thank you. Mr. Lou referred to the structural difficulties. Yes, he's entirely correct. Because the steel units are of irregular shape, and they have to be put at different angles, and they have to be adjusted aside. The assembly is such that we have three big horizontal V trusses divided into 12 spans. We've got 52 such prefabricated units, forming three trusses. As at yesterday, we have installed 42 of them. And of course, we have encountered different challenges. You can imagine, these units were prefabricated, and when they are installed, there may be some adjustment in the assembly. If it is too big or too small, it cannot be assembled. So we've only got 10 units left. In the coming 4 to 6 weeks, they will be all erected. These are very important to the whole glass ceiling, because it will have to be there for installation of the glass ceiling.
After installing all these trusses, we will then work on other parts. So now the progress has been very smooth. Mr. Michael Tien. Concerning this canopy at the terminus, from the beginning till now, well, I have been thinking that this is extremely difficult, and it is something left by the last government. It is really a mess. You said that there are some prefabricated units for those 4,000-odd pieces of glass. There are 4,000-odd pieces of glass to be assembled to form the canopy. These glasses are of different shapes and curvature. Well, this is really unprecedented. I think IEFCICC is such that not all glass pieces are different. So this technology is from a German company, and the pieces will be made in the mainland China. So the design will be computer made, and if there are problems with one or two pieces of glass, then you will have to remake the glasses. So when will you start to assemble these 4,000 odd pieces of glass, and the time when these glass pieces are assembled is one of the most important factors as to whether or not the project can be completed on schedule. Okay, I have a few questions. This German manufacturer will make the glass for you. If some pieces have to be remade, how long would that take? That's my first question. Now, if you want the line to be commissioned in Q3 of 2018, according to your original critical path, when should the first piece of glass be assembled, and when should that be completed? So I'm asking for three figures. Can you give me the information? Dr. Wang, thank you, Chairman. Mr. Tien referred to these challenges, and the points are very valid because there are 4,000 odd glass units of different sizes and shapes to be installed on the canopy. For these 4,000 odd units, we have to use computer design so that all the units' dimensions can be very accurately calculated. For the units, well, they will be made in Tongkun of China. To answer Mr. Tian's question, our units, the first unit will be installed in August this year. I'm referring to the glass units. And of course, to a certain extent, if there is damage, if the dimensions are not suitable, then they have to be remade. For this German manufacturer, the technology is from Germany. The company has experience of making many glass facades in large projects. It is experienced in Hong Kong and in Tongkun, in Dongguan. There is a unit assembly plant of this company, and when necessary, in the production line, the specifications of certain glass units can be accommodated right away. It won't take long to make the glass units. The factory can do it within 2 to 3 weeks. So one glass unit, to remake one glass unit will take 2 to 3 weeks. Well, the glass pieces are already there. But what about having to remake the glass units? The glasses are there already, but the glass will be cut according to the required dimension. And then for the units, aluminium is also used. We're talking about 4,000 odd pieces. If one of the pieces doesn't fit, you have to remake that piece, then how long would it take? 2 to 3 weeks. For example, at the cruise terminal project, time is limited. You just said August. Well, according to your original plan, when should the 4,000 glass units be completed? Next year, in August, all the glass units installation will be completed. So in August last year, next year, we'll know whether the service can be commissioned in 2018. Right. We have to do waterproof work, and then we have to work on the wall and also the glass units. So, Mr. Wu Chi-wai, on delay and cost overrun, all the expert reports said that the critical path is the most important information so that we can do an assessment of whether you can attain your estimated completion date. Now, concerning the remaining work items, so how is the critical path like? We need an overall picture to know whether you can really complete on schedule. Well, if we do not have the critical path, we cannot make a judgment. So will the government present to this subcommittee an overall project progress table and critical path table so that we will know what you said is consistent? For the project contract, it will have to be redrafted, and there should be a completion date in the contract. Have you already assigned contract with the contractors with a project completion date? For the completion date, the contractor can strive for a certain room for delay. What kind of criteria are applied so that contractors can apply for further delay without having further liabilities? Now the new contract is signed. If they cannot complete on schedule, will there be penalty? For the old contract, that is, completion should be in August 2015. Now, it will be delayed to Q3 of 2018. The terms and conditions. I want to know whether the terms and conditions and the penalty clauses are the same. And then, regarding co-location, this is the most critical issue in the discussion. But, Chairman, I don't know whether there is still opportunity to discuss co-location, or should the government give us an account at the next meeting. I would ask the government to give an account of the progress of co-location in the next meeting. Otherwise, our discussion won't be complete. Well, co-location is not within this scope, but FC always said that we should discuss co-location here. This subcommittee is about project progress. Chairman, the chairman of FC asked us to follow up on co-location here. Well, I think that should be done at the traffic panel. Undersecretary, can you please answer the first three questions? Right, Chairman. I will defer to MTRC for the details. Now, concerning critical path, if it is necessary, we can work out a progress timetable. We will go back to prepare the information, but I will ask MTRC to give you an account now. Dr. Wong. Thank you, Chairman. Concerning the overall timetable, well, there is this timetable in our project, that is PMP. In P6, well, we use the P6 planning software to do it. From the beginning till now, we do have a critical path analysis. And our target is commissioning and completion in Q3 of 2018. And we have agreed with contractors to follow this timetable to complete the project. So this date is very clear. Is that a target or completion time? It is a target completion date. That is, in the contract, there is the target completion date and not a completion time in the contract. Please clarify. Well, Chairman, for each item, there is a program to complete. And it's a target. As Mr. Wu said, if the contractor cannot discharge its responsibility to complete the project according to the target date, then they will be subject to a fine, a penalty. There is this clause in the contract. And there is also a buffer, which is in our own, within our own target. If there is weather impact, then we can allow for additional time buffer. Mr. Lee Chuck-yen, well, can there be a written response to my other questions? You can ask your questions in the second round. Chairman, for the XRL project, concerning the 80 billion ceiling, I don't think it is feasible because there are constant cost overruns. Compensation is not included in the 80-odd billion. Now, MTRC will have to shoulder the 20-odd billion compensation claim. Well, at the end of the day, we don't know whether the exact compensation amount will be 20-odd billion because it is subject to arbitration. It may be 10 billion, a few 10 billion, or a few billion. So at the end of the day, you may have to pay more than 80 billion. Another possible claim may be from the government. Because of your mismanagement, there is a delay of 2 years or so, and then there is cost overrun of 20-odd billion. We don't know how much that claim will be. Now, eventually, if you refer to MTRC's accounts, at the end of the day, when you settle the bill, you may have to prepare another 10 to 20 billion. Is that the case? MTRC. Thank you, Chairman. In the paper, there is a number under outstanding claims for that is claims from contractors. According to our information, we think that the claims are justifiable. They encounter different circumstances, so according to contract terms, they can claim compensation. When we assess the claims, our project control team will verify the information. And the information will be passed on to the Highways Department and the government's consultant. And in the process, as in all other projects, the claim information will be dealt with in a stringent way. We will monitor project cost and expenses so that all the expenses will be at the lowest level. I want to ask, who will pay the bill, MTRC or the government? There are two bills, one compensation, second, the government may sue you. So how will the bills be paid, be settled? If the government sues you, then you will pay the bill. What about the claims from other contractors? Dr. Wong? If it is claimed from contractor, which is justifiable, then in the latest revised project cost of 84.4 billion, the bill will be settled out of that. So in other words, the 80 odd billion will include the claim. And does it include 20 odd billion or what? The 20 odd billion may not come true. So out of 80 odd billion, part of the money will be used for paying compensation, right? How much will be that amount?
So, Mina.
The claims are those sought by the contractors. Yes, I know. Out of the 80 billion dollars, how much is reserved for settling the claims? I do not have the details with me at hand. But how come have you arrived at this 80 billion dollars? I was thinking, well, correct me if I'm wrong, I was thinking that 50 odd billion dollars will not cover claims. It was mainly for CTC. So you don't know. I thought you did not know the amount of claims. So what is supposed to be for settling the claims? Director. Slowly, please. The government and our consultant have very carefully considered how the corporation has arrived at this amount. We look at the outstanding amount of works and the expected amount of money for settling the claims. So $84.42 billion, the corporation has already factored in the amount to settle the claims. And as you know, we have signed an agreement with the corporation which will cap the cost if the final bill is over $84.42 billion. The corporation will have to bear it. But this $84.42 billion, well, you have not answered my questions. It is not really appropriate for us to reveal the figures here because the corporation are negotiating with the contractors over the claims. if they know our reserve or our budget and the corporation will be put in a disadvantaged position. Mr. Tan Kapiu, we know most of the excavation works have been completed and you're now starting the E&M installations. So I'd like to know the amount of workers that can be released. In other words, is it true that you will need fewer construction workers? Second, the FC is examining a funding application for extra money. If the item is not resolved, will it be very disadvantageous to your negotiation with contractors when it comes to claims? Will it make it impossible for you to negotiate with the contractors over claims? Dr. Wong. In fact, the labor shortage comes from different trades. Mr. Wong is correct. The high risks procedures are over, so the demand for labor in this regard is slightly relieved. But for building services, fitting out works, E&M installations, there is still a great demand for labor. So when it comes to labor shortage, we still have a problem in these trades. And we are dealing with justified claims. And they are conditions, unforeseen conditions encountered during construction works. So they will talk about delays and not of their responsibility. For stoppage of work, that is another kind of claims, and contractors will advance other justifications for claims.
But would that affect claims already submitted?
If new money doesn't come in time or is not approved, will it make it easier for them to justify their current claims, or are they two separate issues? According to my understanding, claims have to be advanced with different justifications. So I think that should be separated from the already submitted claims. Now we know that the SIL East and KE will be completed within this year. So you have also completed the excavation works here. So what will be the reduction in demand for labor? That's about 15,000 workers. According to information I have, about one-third of the workers will be reduced. So a reduction of 3,000 to 4,000 workers. Okay, second round, two. Mr. Michael Tien and Mr. Wu Chi-wai, 2 minutes each. Chairman, I start to worry listening to Dr. Wong's reply. I know the 4,000 odd glass pieces is very challenging. I didn't know that it would only start in August this year. So, Dr. Wong, would you agree with me that it is only when the 3,999th glass piece has been erected that you can tell when the station can be commissioned? So you told us that you can only tell by August 2017 that you know whether the station can be commissioned in the third quarter of 2018, right?
Thank you, Mr. Tien, for your question.
All works have their different kinds of challenges. Given the size of this project, even if it is over 90% completed, there are still challenges, and the main challenges and risks are how we deal with them. So when we come to the 3,199th glass piece, and if there is something wrong with the size or shape of the 4,000th piece, we still have to fix it before it can be assembled to complete the glass canopy. So I'd like to know whether it is a necessary condition for the glass pieces to be properly assembled for commissioning in third quarter 2018. It's one of the factors. So is it true that we have to wait until August 2017 before you can tell for sure whether the station can be commissioned in the third quarter of 2018? Yes, that's one of the determining factors. Now, if in the unfortunate event that the 4,000th glass has some problem and we have to wait for a while, will we affect that $844 billion? Well, there are a few critical works. This glass panel will be one of the determining factor whether the railway can be commissioned is another critical factor. Now, I'd like to know whether the cap of $844.2 billion will be affected if you cannot commission the station by the third quarter of 2018. Well, after our agreement with the corporation, the cost is capped. Under the agreement, if the final cost is higher or if the time for completion is longer, all the risks will be borne by the corporation. Do you agree, Dr. Wong? Whether he agrees or not doesn't matter because the agreement is also already signed. Mr. Wu Jiwai, I think we have to ask Dr. Wong to say what he agrees with the Highways Department. Now, and even for the third quarter, well, it begins with early June and ends in late September. So do you have any specific contracts signed with the contractors or with the administration? Because perhaps you should use the 5th of August 2018 as a cutting point. And theoretically speaking, the inclement weather will be the only possible factor for extension of project time. So I'd like to know whether that is the only factor for further extension of completion date. If not, what else would there be to affect the progress of works? And the third question, you may reply in writing. Now, for these contracts, they were signed to be completed by the 4th of August 2015. But now they have been extended to, I don't know, the start or end of Q3 2018. I'd like to know the variation in contract cost. Completion date changed from the 4th of August 2015 to the beginning or end of the third quarter 2018. What will be the variation in contract costs? Dr. Wong, extension of work. there are different justifications for extension of contract time under the terms, one of which is inclement weather, making it impossible for works to be completed. It is also something that cannot be foreseen. Another possible justification is change in design. But I'm asking for your own assessment as the chairman, as the manager of the project. What do you think are the possible factors for application of extension of time? The project is already 76% completed, one quarter is left. They're close to 3 years in the completion time, and there are other possible changes. Mr. Wu asked for a written reply for his third question. Do you agree to provide it in writing later? Yes, we will consider, see how we can supplement the information later. All right, then the meeting ends here. We do not have any AOB items, so the meeting is closed.